Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
Dear learners, this is a video for the subject of education for the course of Bachelor's in Education and for the paper of Child Development and Learning. This particular lecture is the part of the major topic of intelligence, and in this lecture we are going to cover the concept of mental age and intelligence quotient. This video is recorded by Dr. Iram Khan. The course coordinator and the presenter or subject matter expert for this video is Dr. Iram Khan from Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. And the academic expert or reviewer for this video is Professor Jaseem Ahmed from Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. This video is produced under the project DTH Swayam Prabha Channels of MHRD, New Delhi. Hello dear learners, I am Dr. Iram Khan, Assistant Professor at IESE, Faculty of Education, Jamia Millia Islamia, New Delhi. In today's session, we are going to take up the major topic of intelligence, where we are going to discuss about the concept of mental age and intelligence quotient. So let us see first the concept of mental age. As we have already understood that there are two types of ages. The first one is the chronological age or the biological age, which can also be clarified as the time which has elapsed or spent since the birth of an individual. And the second one is the mental age. What exactly is this mental age? This is a big question. So mental age is a concept. Basically, this concept was first used by Binet. And this idea of mental age, he explained in a specific way. So mental age is a concept related to intelligence. It looks at how a specific individual, and in most of the cases a child, at a specific age performs intellectually as compared to the average intellectual performance for that individual's or that particular individual's or child's actual chronological age. So now let us try to understand this particular thing with a example. Suppose there is a test which has 100 questions, and this can be seen in one of the standardized tests given by Jalota. So we have seen that for performing this test, whenever we are performing this test on a number of students whose age is 13 years or 14 years and 6 months. Let's take that the age group of the students on which this test is being performed is 14 years and 6 months. So after getting the answer sheets done, we have seen that the students, the number of students who have answered this particular test, around 48 questions was that particular number in which the students have answered successfully. So 48 questions were successfully answered by majority of the students. Then any individual who earns a score of 48, here in this case 48, regardless of his or her chronological age, it can be mentioned or it can be said that will stand to have a mental age of 14 years and 6 months. So this is something through which we can understand. And if you go to the internet, you will find lots and lots of different tests through which you can actually calculate your mental age. So after getting abreast with the mental age, let us understand what exactly intelligence quotient or IQ is. So this term IQ was initially given by German psychologist William Stern, and then it was taken up to wide practice by Terman. So it appeared to Stern that if a child was of 6 years of age, of chronological age, but can do what an 8 years old child normally does, then what we can do? We can just divide the mental age by the chronological age, which would be in this case 8 by 6, and get the IQ of this particular child, which here is going to appear as 1.33. And then there is a standard table where you can just see that what exactly is the type, or what exactly is the intelligence type of this particular child if he is getting this particular IQ of 1.33, which was again a bit refined. So what was earlier done was refined by them, and to do away with this decimal thing, they actually made a multiplication of this particular number with 100. So what exactly was done? The ratio, or the measure of the rate of mental development of an individual, was actually calculated. So the ratio was given the name of intelligence quotient, or IQ. So for as we I just mentioned that to do away with the decimal point, the ratio was again multiplied by 100, and in this way the formula to calculate IQ was actually given by them. So the standard Binet scale through which we can actually assess the IQ, according to the standard Binet scale, the formula to calculate IQ is, we have to divide mental age by chronological age, or CA. So MA is divided by CA, and then it is multiplied by 100. So in this way we can get the IQ of a child, and this is particularly the standard Binet scale. So now let us see that the IQ which we have calculated by the standard Binet formula, if we want to see that what exactly is the level of intelligence of a person who is having a certain IQ, how we can do that? So for that purpose, we have to see the classification of IQ. So what happened that by making the use of the formula of IQ, which was given by Stern, Terman tried to classify the individuals into certain specific categories. So on the basis of the data collected through the administration of his intelligence test, so that he can term the individuals as average, or below average, or above average, or superior, and there is a list of the classified terms. So as you can see here on the screen, there is a table in which you can see the classification of IQ which was given by Terman, and you can see that in the list IQ and level of intelligence are given side by side, and it is very much clearly mentioned that if you read the table downwards, that below 25, if we get the IQ below 25, then this person can be mentioned as, in this category, idiot. Then in 25 to 50 IQ, if a person is getting, then he or she will be in the category of imbecile. 50 to 75, morons. 75 to 90, borderline and dull. 90 to 110 are those individuals who will be lying in the category of normal or average. Then 110 to 120 IQ people will be considered as superiors. Then 120 to 140 will be considered as very superior. And those who are having the IQ above 140 can be considered as gifted or genius. So this is something, the classification which was given for the IQ by Terman. So as far as the Indian scenario is concerned, there are certain little bit of deviations, and here on my screen I have given one more classification of IQ which was given by Professor Uday Shankar, and it seems to be much more suitable for the Indian conditions. So let us see what exactly in this table is actually given. So if we again read this table from downwards. So below 25 IQ'd people will be considered as idiots. Then 25 to 50 imbecile, 50 to 75 morons or feeble-minded. Then 75 to 90 can be considered as borderline and dull. 90 to 110 can be considered as average IQ'd people. 110 to 120 are superiors. 120 to 140 very superior. And again, the genius category will be for those people who have the IQ above 140. So very little bit of deviation can be seen in the classification of IQ, which is given by Terman, and in the classification of IQ, which was given by Professor Uday Shankar. So this was the category of the classification of the IQ. So once we have calculated the IQ, with the help of this table, we can analyze, we can assess that what kind of person this particular individual is, what type of level of intelligence this person is actually having. So this is something through which we can make a kind of analysis of level of intelligence or level of IQ of a person. So the next point for discussion is the constant nature of intelligence quotient. What exactly this is? We have already studied this, or we have already actually mentioned that intelligence goes on growing up till the age of 16 or 18 years of biological age, but IQ for most of the individuals remains constant. Primarily, IQ provides a ratio for knowing how bright an individual is as compared with some of his own age group human beings or individuals. So actually, it is an index which is independent not only of the particular score which an individual makes on a particular scale, but also of the particular age at which he or she happens to make it. It is thus a measure which acquaints us with the relative brightness of intellectual possibilities of any individual. More or less, this particular thing is permanent. So it is true that an individual grows in intelligence, but the whole group, like it's a, because it's a relative term, so if one person's intelligence is growing up, the others who are in the group, they are also growing up in their intelligences. So the other individuals of his own age, because they are also growing up in intelligence, so the same rate, because the growth of intelligence of this individual with the other individuals of the same group is on the same rate. So we can't say that only this individual's IQ is growing up, because everybody else is also having a growth in their IQ. So in this way, a measure of defining relative brightness or intellectual possibilities of an individual remains practically constant. And this particular measure is the IQ. So under the ordinary circumstances, suppose a person undergoes an accident or some disease, some mental disease or some type of disorder, in that case the scenario will be different. But under the ordinary circumstances, an individual's IQ is supposed to remain constant throughout his life, or at least throughout the age limits covered by the scale. So this property of IQ is referred to as the constancy of IQ by different psychologists. And these psychologists actually include Garrett and Schoeneck and many more psychologists. So this is something which is given by these people. So we can say that to a certain extent, the IQ of a human being is constant. Now, once we are talking about the constancy of the IQ, there is a controversy which is related to the nature of intelligence, which we need to mention. So measures such as mental age and IQ have their limitations. Binet did not believe these measures represented a single permanent and inborn level of intelligence. He basically stressed that intelligence overall is too broad to be represented by a single number. It is influenced by many factors such as the individual's or human being's background, and because the background or the environment has got changes over the time is actually spent by this individual. So he was having a kind of divided opinion about the constancy of the IQ. So throughout much of the 20th century, many psychologists believe that intelligence was fixed and hereditary, while others believed that believed that other factors would affect the intelligence. So this was something which was actually kind of controversial till the 20th century. So after World War I, the concept of intelligence was considered as fixed, hereditary, and unchangeable. This particularly became the dominant theory within the experimental psychological community. By the mid-1930s, there was no longer agreement among researchers on whether or not intelligence was hereditary. So again, there was a confusion. So there are still recurring debates going on about the influence of environment and heredity upon any individual's intelligence. So we can't actually dogmatize this particularly concept of intelligence, that this is constant or it is not affected by the environment, because we have seen in certain situations that if even two identical twins are kept in different environments, they actually develop different levels of IQs, and vice versa is also seen in few of the cases. So with this, we have now come to a summary of this particular lecture. We have seen in this lecture the concept of mental age and IQ, and we have seen that the mental age and IQ is put into use for interpreting the raw scores earned on an intelligence test. The term mental age, which was coined by Binet, stands for the mental level of a child against the level which is normally for the majority of children of his or her age. For the computation of IQ, we make use of the formula IQ is equal to mental age divided by chronological age and then multiplied by 100. So the data which was collected after administration of the intelligence test have helped the psychologists to classify individuals into certain specific categories of average, below average, above average, superior, genius type of intelligence. So it has helped us in the diagnosis and identification of gifted, backward, mentally subnormal, or mentally abnormal children among a particular group of population. So the result derived on the basis of IQ measurement, this IQ measurement has revealed one of its unique characteristics. We have seen that this particular characteristic can be mentioned as the constancy of IQ. It postulates that IQ, a measure of defining relative brightness or the intellectual possibilities of an individual, remains practically constant throughout his or her life, or at least throughout the age limits covered by the scale. And this is something which is not very much acclaimed. It has got lots and lots of controversies, because lots and lots of people, psychologists, have the opinion that IQ is also affected by the change of environment and scenarios in which, and the context in which the child or the human being is in. So there are certain controversies which are actually prevailing from ages, and still they are there related to the IQ or the intelligence of an individual. So with this, now we are concluding this particular lecture. I hope that the topic of intelligence, IQ, mental age, and how to calculate mental age, all these things have now become clear to you, and you will be in a position to solve the numericals and the problems which are related to IQ. With this, I will end my session. See you in another session. Thank you so much. Dear students, here are few of the links of suggestive videos for calculating your mental age. By the help of these videos, you can calculate your mental age, and with the help of that calculated mental age, you can assess your IQ. Dear learners, we were watching a video from the major topic of intelligence, and this lecture was based on the concept of mental age and intelligence quotient. This video lecture was recorded by faculty at home during the national lockdown period for COVID-19 pandemic using minimal technical resources. Technical errors, if any, are unintentional and may please be ignored. For any queries with regard to this lecture or broadcast, kindly send your email to techsupport@dth.ac.in. Thank you so much.